The ungodly, are not so, but are like the chaff. Not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Lord, who shall abide in thy tabernacle? Who shall dwell in thy holy hill? He that walketh uprightly, and worketh righteousness, and speaketh the truth in his heart. He that backbiteth not with his tongue, nor doeth evil to his neighbor, nor taketh up a reproach against his neighbor, in whose eyes a vile person is contemned, but he honoreth them that fear the Lord. He that sweareth to his own hurt and changeth not. He that putteth not out his money to usury, nor taketh reward against the innocent. He that doeth these things shall never be moved. God is our light and our salvation. Whom shall we fear? The Lord is the strength of our life. Of whom shall we be afraid? I heard a songwriter say, if when you give the best of your service, telling the world that the Savior is come, be not dismayed that when men don't believe you, he understands. He'll say, well done. Oh, when I come to the end of my journey, weary of life, and the battle is won, there will be joy for each trial and temptation. He'll understand and say, well done. Misunderstood, the Savior of sinners hung on the cross. He was God's only Son. Oh, hear him, his call, his Father in heaven. Let not my will, but thine be done. But if you try and fail in your trying, hands sore and scarred from the work you've begun, take up your cross. Run quickly to meet him. He'll understand. He'll say, well done. Oh, when I come to the end of my journey, weary of life, and the battle is won, there will be joy for each trial and temptation. He'll understand and say, well done. But if you try and fail in your trying, hands sore and scarred from the work you've begun, take up your cross. Run quickly to meet him. He'll understand. He'll say, well done. And when his life of labor is ended, and reward for the race you have won, yours will be sweet rest prepared for the faithful, given with his blessed and loving well done. Oh, when I come to the end of my journey, weary of life, and the battle is won, there will be joy for each trial and temptation. He'll understand and say, well done. Well done, thy good and faithful servant. Well done. We serve a God of love. We serve a God of great compassion. We serve a God who looks upon God's faithful and says, well done, my good and faithful servant, well done. He will understand and say, well done. Then I could hear the voice of Mahalia Jackson sing, precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, and lead me home. When my way grows drear, precious Lord, linger near. When my life is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call, hold my hand, lest I fall. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on and let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. When the darkness appears and night draws near, and the day is past and gone, at the river I stand, guide my feet, hold my hand, take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
God is the joy and the strength of my life. He moves all pain, misery, and strife. He promised to keep me, never to leave me. Keep my life clean.
lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from time forth and even forevermore. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. I am the way, the truth, and the life. If ye love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another Comforter, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwelleth with you. He dwelleth with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you, because I live, ye shall live also. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Amen, amen, amen. We have gathered here on this day to celebrate the life of a legend. We have come here on this day to give honor unto a man who did great work in the city of Gary. We have come to celebrate this day because we know that God's word says that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And so to Mrs. Christine Clay and to Rudy Clay Jr., God bless you, for we know that while mourning, your weeping may endure for a moment. Joy shall come in the morning. And so we have come to celebrate the life of your husband, of your father, of your brother, of your friend, of a great politician, and not only that, a faithful member of Israel CME Church. And as I have learned, seeing this great cloud of preachers and witnesses, this man was truly loved not only by the CME Church, but he was loved by the AME Church, and I know that he was loved by a host of other denominations, and certainly including the Baptist Church, where one Baptist preacher told me that he believed he was a closet Baptist member, but we know that he was a CME. Amen. Through and true, as he spent his entire life at Israel CME Church, but never failed to give support to other churches because we make up one body. And we know that when we get to heaven, there will be no Methodists, there will be no Baptists, there will be no Pentecostal, there will be no AME, there will be no AME Zion. We will all be together as one body of Christ. Amen. On today, we will follow the order of services. We shall have the Lord's Prayer, sang by Vanessa Allen, and then the invocation by Reverend Charles Emery of Pilgrim Missionary Baptist Church.
Hallowed would be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done.
Let us pray. Our God, our Father, our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. It is again, our Father, that we humbly and submissively come before your presence with thanksgiving and with praise. Our Father, we realize that you, being God, rules the heaven and the earth, and you have all power in the palm of your hand. We thank you for this day that we assemble ourselves together here at the Genesis Center in behalf of Mayor Rudolph Clay and family. We pray your blessings, Master, upon this family in a special way as we come collectively, pastors and preachers and evangelists, political leaders, state representatives and senators. Thank you, Master, for all of these great people who've taken time out of their busy schedule to make up this assembly today to say to the Clay family that we love you, we appreciate you, and we are concerned about your condition. Our Father, we thank you for another day that you allowed us to enjoy a reasonable portion of health and strength. Our Father, we thank you for all of these who are assembled here at this moment. Thank you for our mayor, Sister Karen Freeman Wilson. We thank you, Lord, for Reverend Jesse Jackson, took time to come to show his love and support. Thank you, Lord, for Judge Mathis. We thank you for all of these dignitaries, social justice leaders who come to say that we appreciate the time that you allotted Brother Rudolph Clay to dwell among us, to rub shoulders with us, to labor and co-labor together. Our Father, as we humbly approach your throne of grace, we thank you, Master, that we had an opportunity to get to know him publicly and privately. We thank you, first of all, for the legacy that he left behind. We will always remember him for his walk. Mr. Clay walked circumspectly before you. His conduct was superb. His character was superb. His conversation was so acceptable and uplifting. Not only his walk, but we thank you, Lord, for the work that he did while you left him here. He was concerned especially about elderly people. Lord, we thank you that he was concerned about impoverished people. He was concerned about helping folk that couldn't help themselves. Lord, we thank you today. We thank you not only for his walk and his work, but we thank you, Lord, that you put within his heart a willingness to worship. Lord, we had a political leader that didn't mind going to church. Lord, every time we had major church activities and programs, he would always show up to let us know that his political achievement did not erase the fact that he was a child of God. And Lord, we thank you today. We know that you're able to do exceptionally, exceedingly, abundantly above all that we might ask or think. We come now in behalf of this wife who loved her husband, who loved the community, who was concerned about helping him to reach the highest level that he could achieve. Thank you for his son. Thank you for his family. Lord, we thank you for just being so good to us. And Lord, Gary will never forget him. We would always make sure that his name is remembered for the time and the labor and the work that he did in this community. Lord, we thank you now. And we pray today for the preacher that will be bringing your word, that you will give this preacher power to preach. Open up the understanding that she might just pull out golden spiritual nuggets, and that all of us will hear word from the Lord. We thank you now, Lord. Lord, we thank you so much that we just want to praise and worship and magnify your name. We didn't come here to pitch a pity party. We came here to celebrate the homegoing of Mr. Rudolph Clay. Lord, we ask you to just put your spirit within us, that we might elevate ourselves above weeping, that we might rejoice and just give your name the praise and the glory. Lord, you've been good to us. Thank you for 77 years that you allowed him to work among your people. Thank you, Lord. Now, Lord, keep your loving arms around us. Lord, we know we got some other folk who are going to have to step up to the plate. But we know, Lord, if you give them the go-ahead, if you fill them with your presence, if you overshadow them with your spirit, Lord, our city need a blessing. And we pray that the call of Rudolph Clay would be a call of your people to unite together, that we might make this city what you want it to be. Lord, we thank you that you're breaking down the walls of partition that separate us by denomination. Help us, Lord, to come together as one community, and that we will work together, that we will labor together, that we will work together, and we'll give your name the praise. Hallelujah! Glory to your name. Hallelujah! Thank you, Jesus. Be with us, stand by us, keep us in your care, and we'll continue to give your name the praise. And all of the people of God said amen. And amen and amen.
Amen. Praise God. At this time, we will have an Old Testament scripture reading by Reverend Monte Williams, Associate Minister at Israel CME Church. Following that, the New Testament reading by Reverend Rodney Griffin, Jr. of St. John Baptist Church.
Psalms 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases, who redeemeth thy life from destruction, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfieth thy mouth with good things, so that thy youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord executeth righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed. He made known his ways unto Moses, his acts unto the children of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and plenteous in mercy. He will not always chide, neither will he keep his anger forever. He hath not dealt with us after our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. For as the heaven is high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward them that fear him. As far as the east is from the west, he removed our transgressions from us. Like as a father pitieth his children, so the Lord pitieth them that fear him. For he knoweth our frame. He remembereth that we are dust. As for man, his days are grass, as a flower of the field, so he flourished. For the wind passeth over it, and it's gone, and the place thereof shall know it no more. But the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting upon them that fear him, and his righteousness unto children's children, to such as keep his covenant, to those that remember to do his commandments. The Lord has prepared his throne in the heavens, and his kingdom ruleth over all. Bless the Lord, ye his angels, that excel in strength, that do his commandments, hearkening to the voice of his word. Bless ye the Lord, all ye his hosts, ye ministers of his that do his pleasure. Bless the Lord, all his works, and all places of his dominion. Bless the Lord, O my soul. The word of God for all people. Thanks be to God.
It appears that Reverend Rodney Griffin Jr. is not here, and I am going to ask that Reverend Chet Johnson come forward and read John 5, 19 through 29.
John chapter 5, verses 19 through verse 29. Then answered Jesus and said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself but what he seeth the Father do. For what things soever he doeth, these also doeth the Son likewise. For the Father loveth the Son and showeth him all things that himself doeth, and he will show him greater works than these, that ye may marvel. For the Father raiseth up the dead and quickeneth them, even so the Son quickeneth whom he will. For the Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment unto the Son, that all men should honor the Son, even as they honor the Father. He that honoreth not the Son honoreth not the Father which hath sent him. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the hour is coming, and now is, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear shall live. For the Father hath life in himself, so hath he given to the Son to have life in himself, and hath given him authority to execute judgment also, because he is the Son of Man. Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming, in the which all that are in the grave shall hear his voice, and shall come forth, they that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and the hearing of his word. Amen.
As we prepare to receive the musical selection, Oh Give Thanks, by the community choir, I am going to ask that an usher on my left would bring programs to the podium, please, to the dais.
Thank you.
And oh, give thanks unto the Lord. We know that the Lord is good and his mercy endures forever. We will now have acknowledgments by LaLosa Dent Burns, former press secretary to Mayor Clay.
The acknowledgments. For the funeral services of the Honorable Rudolph Rudy Clay, this Wednesday, June 12th, 2013, at the 11 o'clock hour. Giving honor where honor is due, our Almighty God, Mayor Karen Freeman Wilson, officiant Reverend Stephanie Welch, presiding elder Essie Clark George, all members of the dais, pastors, elected officials, and others. If I may take the liberty to ask that before we begin our acknowledgments that all elected officials that Mayor Rudy Clay has worked with over the past 40 years, please stand at this time. Thank you. The Clay family is well beloved and known by many, many people, especially over the 40 years that Mayor Rudy Clay represented and served this great community of the city of Gary. So I am sure you can imagine the outpour of resolutions, cards, letters of condolence, and sentiments that have been received by the Clay family. As protocol has been established for this service today will only allow a brief time. We will read just a few resolutions and give a few acknowledgments. Moreover, we acknowledge today all resolutions, all letters from U.S. officials, from state officials, from city officials, from neighboring mayors and other officials from all cities in the region and from all over this country. We say thank you. All will be read by the family privately and acknowledged at a later time. Resolution. United States Congress, U.S. House of Representatives, Washington, D.C. Tribute to the Honorable Rudy Clay, former mayor of Gary, Indiana. Reverend clergy, Mrs. Clay, members of the Clay family, Mayor Karen Freeman Wilson, elected officials, citizens of Gary, and friends of Rudy Clay. My duties in Washington as a member of Congress have prevented my attendance at the funeral services today. But I want all of you to know that I have known Rudy for more than 40 years. And I have always thought of him as being one of the most committed elected officials and genuine human beings I have ever known. From state senator to mayor, Rudy, like many people our ages, were actively involved in the civil rights movement of the 60s and the 70s and never stopped being involved for being engaged until the good Lord said it was time to go. Rudy loved politics and held practically every office that one could possibly hold in Lake County. But more than politics, he loved his family and friends. and he loved Gary, Indiana. I've had the good fortune to visit the Clay home, and I want to thank Mrs. Christine Clay for her kind, generous hospitality, and may the soul of our departed friend and brother, Mayor Rudolph Clay, rest in peace. Sincerely, Danny K. Davis, U.S. Congressman, 7th District of Illinois. Israel CME Church, resolution. In loving memory of Mayor Rudy Clay, although it's difficult today to see beyond the sorrow, may looking back in memory help to comfort you tomorrow. Whereas the divine providence of God has brought to a close the life of Mayor Rudy Clay, the pastor, members of Israel Christian Methodist Episcopal Church in Gary, Indiana, acknowledge with sorrow his passing. Whereas Mayor Rudy Clay suffered much physical pain in his lifetime that none of us will ever fully comprehend, yet lived such a manner that he touched many lives with his example of love and acceptance. Whereas Mayor Rudy Clay demonstrated a lifelong commitment to God through his faithful service to the church. Whereas we bow in humble submission to the will of God and commend the bereaved family to the Creator, who sees all and knows every heart. We encourage the family to be consoled by the hope of a reunion. For the Lord God himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with a trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Therefore, let it be known that we recognize the deep loss and sorrow your family is experiencing. We share in your sorrow, but recognize that the Lord God has accepted into his presence a good and faithful servant. Lovingly submitted, Israel Christian Methodist Episcopal Church, Reverend Stephanie A. Welsh, pastor. The Michigan-Indiana Region Annual Conference of the 3rd Episcopal District of the Christian Methodist Episcopal Church, Reverend Dr. S.E.D. Clark George, presiding elder, Gary District. The family of Mayor Rudy Clay, the Bishop, Paul A.G. Stewart, First Lady, presiding elder, and First Gentleman, pastors, district officers, and members of the Michigan-Indiana Region, 3rd Episcopal District of the Christian Methodist Episcopal Church, bow our heads in humble submission to God. His perfect will will extend our right hand of fellowship, prayers, and support to the family in the passing of Mayor Rudy Clay. It's heaven's gain. Yet we know that God, in God's divine providence and wisdom, removed Mayor Clay from among us, who will be missed and is one of God's treasures. And we know that death leaves its sting and accompanying sorrow. But we as God's children have learned to live in faith and trust that God does all things well. He will sustain us even in times of death. Humbly submitted, Reverend Dr. S.E.D. Clark George, presiding elder, Mr. Roger C. George, Jr., First Gentleman, Michigan-Indiana Region, 3rd Episcopal District of the Christian Methodist Episcopal Church, Bishop Paul A.G. Stewart, Sr., presiding prelate, Mrs. M. Earlene Stewart, First Lady. We'd like to acknowledge that a resolution has been placed in the Congressional Record, United States Congressional Record, the House of Representatives, by U.S. Congressman Pete Pasklowski. We'd also like to acknowledge a resolution received by the Gary branch of the NAACP, where Stephen C. Mays is president, where Mayor Clay was a charter member. Also a charter member of the Indiana Democratic African American Caucus, a resolution has been sent. We acknowledge this organization again where Mayor Rudy Clay was a charter member. Weights and Measures Department, Lake County Government. Our condolence to Mrs. Christine Clay and the entire Clay family. For in times like these, we know that pain and sorrow comes, but our memories keeps us glued together, that we won't become broken pieces. Mrs. Clay, as you have shared special moments with us, your staff, we kindly remember these sentiments pouring from your heart. Not how did he die, but how did he live? Not what did he gain, but what did he give? These are the units to measure the worth of a man as a man, regardless of birth. Not what was his church, nor what was his creed. Was he ever ready, with word of good cheer, to bring back a smile to banish a tear? Now, what did the sketch in the newspaper say? But how many were sorry when he passed away? Humbly submitted the Weights and Measures Department, Lake County Government, where Christine S. Clay is director. The family of Mayor Rudy Clay expresses a sincere and heartfelt gratitude for the outpouring support through expressions of condolence, care, and concern. We are sincerely gratified to know that so many people loved Rudy. The numerous acts of kindness have brought comfort to our hearts during this time. The expressions of sympathy and love and the many prayers offered will be acknowledged at a later day. May God bless and keep each and every one of you. And one last resolution. A resolution to honor the memory of Rudolph Clay, Sr. Whereas Rudolph Clay was born July 16, 1935 in Hillsboro, Alabama, he moved with his family to Gary, Indiana, where he lived until the age of 77. And whereas Mayor Clay married the love of his life, Christine, and shared that love with her for more than 55 years. And whereas their sacred union of marriage yielded their one and only son, Rudolph Clay, Jr. And whereas Mayor Clay served this community in many capacities, including the United States Army, Prudential Insurance, State Farm Insurance, the Civil Rights Movement, the Israel CME Church, the Indiana State Senate, the Indiana Democratic Party, the Lake County Council, the Gary Democratic Precinct Organization, the City of Gary, and numerous other organizations. And whereas Mayor Clay was an outstanding public servant with countless accomplishments, including earning the Operation Breadbasket Outstanding Activist Award and the Outstanding Hoosier Award, marching alongside Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., becoming the first African-American Lake County Commissioner, becoming the first African-American Indiana State Senator, serving as Lake County Councilman, serving as Lake County Democratic Party Chairman, and lastly, serving as Mayor of the City of Gary. And whereas the citizens of Gary were greatly saddened to learn of the passing of the former Mayor, Rudolph Clay, Sr., a beloved leader in the City of Gary, Northwest Indiana, and the State of Indiana. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the lifelong accomplishments of Rudolph Clay, Sr., and his undying love for the City of Gary and its citizens will forever be a part of the rich history of Gary, Indiana, and his legacy will never be forgotten. Signed, the Mayor of the City of Gary, Karen Freeman Wilson. We'd like to announce that following the services, there will be a repast for the family, the extended family and friends, elected officials and other dignitaries. The preparation for the repast, ladies and gentlemen, has been limited, so we ask that you govern yourselves accordingly. Thank you. And finally, and the most important, to the family, we know your loss is deep and your sorrow is great. And although we share in your sorrow, we pray and know that God's everlasting love and peace will comfort you and comfort your heart during this time. God has blessed Mayor Rudy Clay. God's blessings to you forever. Thank you.
Truly, we have come to honor the life of a legend, the Honorable Rudolph Clay, former mayor of Gary, Indiana. Well, now we will have remarks from the Honorable Judge Greg Mathis, TV personality, and then following that will be Reverend Jesse Jackson, Sr., founder and president of Rainbow Push Coalition in Chicago, Illinois.
Thank you. I used to give stump speeches, but I don't think I need the stump today. To Reverend Welch, to Reverend Jackson, our dear Mayor Freeman Wilson, to all the elected officials and the clergy, but most of all to Mrs. Clay, to young brother Clay Jr., to all the family members of perhaps one of the greatest men to come out of Gary. Let me offer my sincere condolence and suggest that you put your hand in God's hand, as you already know, and he will be your comforter. And let the pride of his work also live on with you and within your hearts in the love of Gary that you'll no doubt feel throughout your journey here. You know, I came up, and Reverend Jackson and with all the clergy may have saw him whisper to me a little bit, and said, "Judge, what are you doing up here? This is for the clergy." Well, Reverend, you're supposed to know your Bible. God chose judges to lead his people during the Old Testament. Samuel was a judge. And years ago, I prayed, I said, "God, I'd like to be a judge so that I could lead my people." I'm sorry, I said, "I'd like to be a clergyman so I could help lead my people." He said, "Well, young Mr. Mathis, I'll put a robe on you, but you're not righteous enough to be clergy. I'll just get you a position with a robe." Speaking of which, I may and will have to leave shortly. This is a tape day for me in downtown Chicago, and the studio was a little concerned about me being late, but I was more concerned about being here for my friend and my leader. Because were it not for him and others like him, I would not have a television show with an African-American on television every day. It was the struggle of he and many others and the sacrifices they made that have opened the door for my generation. And I am clear, were it not for his work, because there's nothing really special about me. There's nothing special about my generation. What is special is the generation that fought and sacrificed for me, and Mayor Clay was part of that generation. He was a civil rights leader and a civil rights activist. That led to his leadership as an elected official. And I call him elected official because he wasn't just a politician. Politicians aren't always leaders. But he was a leader first among the public. Certainly he was a husband, and he was a father, and he was a son of God above all. But in the community of Gary, he was a leader. I met Mayor Clay and during his time as a commissioner, and he invited me to come and participate with a program here in Gary, and I obliged because you all have pretty much the same demographics and challenges as Detroit, and those challenges are deep in my heart. And that's what God, I believe, prepared me to address: the challenges of the poor, the challenges of the minority, or the African Americans specifically. And so I readily wanted to join in making a difference here in Gary. So I came to that, and then we began to work together on other events. We had a youth and education crusade here where over 2,000 people came to access many of the resources that myself, my staff, and Mayor Clay were able to bring here, signing young people up for the education and recreation programs, signing parents up for parenting classes, all the things that Mayor Clay knew would help uplift the city. And then, beyond some of the community events, he invited me, and I was felt a special pride in being a part of the dedication of the world-famous Jackson Home, which commemorated the most famous son and family in Gary, Indiana's history, that being Michael Jackson and his family. So I was proud to be involved. And you should know, those who watch my show, for years you saw his face at the beginning of my show. That expo, that education expo I spoke of, was taped, and we put a little five-second segment on the preamble of the show. And between that and the coverage he received from the Michael Jackson and the sideburns that became world famous, I'd be around the country speaking, and they'd say, "Judge, we watch the show, and at the beginning of the show, there's a guy with some sideburns that pretty distinguished. And who is that?" I said, "That's my man, Rudy Clay, out of Gary." And so he became world famous, quite frankly. But you know, with all the fame and fortune, he never took his eyes off of Gary. Never took his eye off Gary. He loved Gary. And he seemed to know everybody in Gary. Over 250,000 people, every time we go anywhere, he'd walk up to people and he'd know their name. I said, "Mr. Mayor, how do you know all these people's names?" He said, "Well, to become a leader of a city and to have hundreds of thousands of people vote for you, you have to work in the community. This doesn't come by, you don't learn folks' name by television ads." You know their name by being with them and helping them and uplifting them and empowering them in their community. And that's what he was about. Mayor Clay was always there to help fight our battle. Whether it was fighting against the corporate abandonment that caused so many challenges here, whether it was fighting against the overt and subtle racism that we've seen here and around Gary and other urban areas, he was there, right there on the front line. And he was there for us. And I thank God, myself, and so many others are here for him today. He would love this. And now that his fight is over, we must pick up the baton of that fight. We must continue to fight so we can allow him to rest in peace. May God bless the family and may God bless all of Gary, Indiana. Thank you for having me.
To Mrs. Clay and members of the family, to Pastor Welch, Judge Mathis, who has such a marvelous story in his own right. Many years ago, I met Judge Mathis in jail, not as a visitor, but as a resident. And he could not hear the voice of the preacher, not that of his praying mother, not that of his father. In time, he ended up in jail. And like Rudy and others of us to go to the jails to speak to the youth in jail, many of them, it seems, kind of fall asleep when you're challenging them not to dig a deeper hole. And Judge Mathis heard our voice. He came out of jail. He never got his high school diploma. He got his GED. He finished college. He finished law school. He couldn't practice because he had a record. He had to fight to get his record expunged. He then became the youngest judge in the history of Michigan. He worked for Congressman John Conyers and for Rainbow Push. He is now TV judge Greg Mathis. His journey from jail to judgeship is a source of inspiration. We thank you, Judge. I want to ask the ministers, please stand, ministers. Give them a hand, please. Since all of us cannot express ourselves on this program, we want to. You are here today not because you were drafted. You're here because you volunteered to say something, to express yourself in some way. I want all of you to get on your feet and give Rudy Clay a big round of applause. Show your love. On your feet. Get up. Put your hand together. Put your hand together. Put your hand together. For his sideburns, for his bell-bottom britches, put your hand together. Put your hand together for Rudy's work. Put your hand together like you really, really mean it. Like you really mean it. Let me hear you scream. Love you, Rudy. Smile, style, profile, bell bottom pants and sideburns. This is a challenge to be here today because of our kinship across the years. Ministers, you know that there are some very difficult expressions you have to give. Sometimes you speak. When there's a political occasion, then you're simply celebrating somebody because of a given attainment they had. The most difficult is to give an expression over someone, your friend's friend, who you did not know. You have to get up and say what they did not do. And you have to imagine a life they didn't live. That's called hallucinating. But you'd be doing your best to be generous. But in this case, we knew and know the spirit of Rudy Clay. And we thank God for his presence. It's all kind of history color. Even in this day, June 12th, is they met Edwards was assassinated 50 years ago. We're here today on that precious day. He's in that legacy. July 16th is the day I first went to jail 52 years ago. And that great legacy of freedom fighters is some Rudy Clay. Why are we here? because we couldn't help it. He preaches eulogy with his actions, with his work. I first met Rudy around 1965 and 6 when Dr. King first came to Gary. The two major splits in town. One was the whites at that time did not want an African-American mayor. And when Hatcher won, they made it on, created Merrillville out of a farm. And the blacks who wanted to hold on because they had the inside track on the old order. Then that was this creative group, this Lou Drinkard and Rudy Clay in that generation. Rudy chose the right side of history. As he fought to become an elected official, with great integrity, he chose the right side of history. When Gary deindustrialized and the mills left, Rudy stayed. He chose the right side of history. When he created the Merrillville out of a farm, Rudy stayed. He chose the right side of history. He is the heart and soul of some place called Gary, Indiana. He organized the 1971 Black Political Convention here in Gary. Rudy Clay was a part of that. Helping to form the Genesis Center, he was a part of that. Everything that mattered in his lifetime, he was here. And from the politics of elections and voter registration and the like, to the Jackson Foundation, to the Jackson Celebration, Rudy never missed a beat. We learn even today, men who are here today in a special way, prostate cancer, at our ages, don't miss a beat. We learn even today that we must accept that challenge, accept that responsibility. He keeps on teaching today. We know Rudy and smiling and styling and profiling. We also know him as a servant. We know him as a suffering servant. Worked when he was sick. We know him as a sacrificing servant. We know him as a successful servant. And if we leave him in the ground today and don't finish his work, then he is dead. We who live have the power to let him live beyond the grave. If we work, particularly you, Rudy Jr., if you keep his work alive, he's alive, he passes blood on to you. He passed his spirit on to you. And so there is something in the faith called he can keep on living after he dies. But this is a temporary shelter. He's going on to a higher place and a greater place even now. We thank God for Rudy having come this way. And all of us are looking at your faces. We'll be here not long from now. But let me submit to you that we're known in the end not by the clothes we wear. We can only take one suit of dress with us. I've been blessed to preach the funeral of Samuel Davis Jr. and Joe Lewis and Junior Gilliam and Cannonball and Adderley and many great and famous people. They never had the U-Haul attached to the hearse. You can only take what you bought, and that's your body, and leave a legacy of service. And we're here today because Rudy served. And you can no longer walk as you once walked, or ran as you once. You be satisfied. You made the new day the new day. And that's what Judge Mathis seeks to acknowledge, that you made the new day. You're the group that came up here from Mississippi and Alabama and Georgia. You tore down the cotton curtain. You made the new day the new day. You made Gary the center of our political culture. Before we had an African-American mayor in America, we had one in Gary. You made the new day the new day. This is the home of the free first saw the Jackson Five at the political rallies held by Lou Drinkard, held by Rudy Clay. The Jackson Five didn't just happen. They were caused. They came out of the soul of Gary. Somehow you made the new day the new day. So the writer says it most profoundly. He said, if when you give the best of your service, telling the world that the Savior has come, be not dismayed when men don't believe you. He'll understand and say, well done. Misunderstood, the Savior of sinners, hung on the cross, was God's only son. Oh, hear him calling his Father in heaven, let not my will, but thine be done. Carrying the staff and the cross of redemption, he'll understand and say, well done. He'll understand and say, well done. Oh, when this life of labor's ended, and the reward of the race you have run. Oh, the sweet rest that's prepared for the faithful will be his best and final. But if you fail in your trials, your trying hand, sore and scarf in the work you have begun, take up your cross quickly to meet him. He'll understand and say, well, Rudy, well done, faithful servant. Rest in his arms. God bless. We love you so much. We will not let you die. Love you very much, church.
Amen. At this time, we will have tributes from Mayor Karen Freeman Wilson, City of Gary. We will have Mark Lopez for Peter Visklowski, United States Congressman. Following that, Erlene Rogers, Indiana State Senator. Robin Winston, Indiana Democratic Party. Roosevelt Allen, President of Lake County and Lake County Commissioner. Elsie Franklin, Lake County Councilwoman. In that order.
Praise the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endures forever. To our officiant today, Pastor Stephanie Welsh, to all of the members of this distinguished dais, to the members of the clergy, to the elected officials, to all of the citizens of Gary, to the citizens of the County of Lake, the state of Indiana, and to all of us who are bound together this afternoon in our memories and our desire to commemorate the life and legacy of a political giant, Mayor Rudy Clay Jr. Good afternoon. I'm Mayor Rudy Clay Sr. Good afternoon. I first want to extend my heartfelt condolences on behalf of my family, my husband Carmen, my daughter Jordan, and our entire family, as well as on behalf of the citizens of this community, to Mrs. Christine Clay, to Rudy and Latoya, and to this entire Clay family. I want you to know that as many people have come today and yesterday and have been around the house over this past week, it does not end here. We are not going anywhere. We will be here to support you because we appreciate your willingness to sacrifice your husband, your father, for us. And so the community has your back. I also want to say to Mrs. Christine Clay, a pillar of quiet strength, until you cross her, you have shown this community, particularly this community of women, what it means to be a wife in the tradition of the virtuous woman. You have also made it okay to be willing to stand by your man up to and including sacrificing your own dreams. And you've done it with grace and a sense of fierce protection that all of us should emulate. Thank you, Soror, for that example. To Rudy Jr., my classmate, you have added years to your own life for your devotion and support of your parents and for the way you have honored your dad. As an only child growing up, I know that comes with great privileges, but it also comes with great responsibility. And you have been exemplary in your care. To John and Belt, and to all of the throngs of friends of Mayor Clay, you have lost a friend, but you have all been loyal to the end. You know, I like to think of myself as an extemporaneous speaker, and I rarely write notes, but there are some times when you just want to get it right. And when you celebrate the life of a man who has given so much to so many, I would dare say that that is one of those times. But then it occurred to me that it's really not humanly possible to acknowledge the life of service in such a limited time. And so what I will say to you, and most of you know this for yourselves, I would dare say all of you know this for yourselves, is that Rudy Clay Sr. has left an indelible mark on this community. Whether you think about his ability to be everywhere all the time, whether you think about the wheelchair ramps, the reduced garbage bills, or the kids that Santa forgot, whether you think about his quips of good roots, good fruits, or the best is yet to come, or whether you think about his great love of God, his family, and his community, he will be remembered as an icon for years to come. Yesterday, Marjo Collette said, I'm sorry, Karen, but I love Rudy more than you. And when I was coming up earlier today, she apologized. But I wasn't offended then, and quite frankly, I knew that she wasn't the only one. So I never had a problem with that. You know, the mayor and I were opponents on two occasions. But the interesting thing, and it almost seemed strange to me, was that we never competed. And, you know, that may sound like an oxymoron to some of you. And I wonder why that was at first. Initially, I thought it was because his son and I were classmates, and I always knew him as Rudy Jr.'s dad. And I said, no, that really wasn't it. And then I thought that maybe it was because we were church mates. And, you know, our pastors would only let us go so far, but that really wasn't it either. But then it occurred to me that we were never competing because I understood that while I was in elementary school, Mayor Rudy Clay was breaking down barriers in the insurance industry. I understood that while I was still thinking about what I wanted to be, Mayor Rudy Clay was blazing a trail in county and state and city government so I could be whatever I wanted to be. And I understand that while it may have been easy for him to sit back and enjoy the fruits of him and Chris's labor, he had that Harriet Tubman spirit that made him want to reach back and go back and lift up others over and over and over again. I understand that he paved the way for me in City Hall during a time when this community was troubled on every side. And because I understood those facts, I never found it necessary to elevate myself by standing on his back. Because from his spirit and example, I knew that he was determined to allow me to stand on his shoulders. And so I simply want to paraphrase the words of one of his favorite songs and simply say thank you, Mayor Clay. Thank you for your example of compassion, diplomacy, and how to work a room like no one else. Like many in this room and out of it, I learned many lessons from Mayor Clay. He had a PhD in political strategy. But the greatest lesson that I learned from him over and over again was that people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And so I say today that may all of us who profess our love for this city in the tradition of Mayor Clay take to heart his example that love is an action word. God bless you, Mayor Clay. May you rest in peace.
Thank you very much. Congressman Pete Biskowski regrets he's unable to join Mrs. Christine Clay, Mr. Rudy Clay Jr., along with your family and friends, as we take this opportunity to remember and celebrate Mayor Rudy Clay and his many accomplishments. Most notably, his undying commitment and wavering commitment for the great people of Northwest Indiana, but more importantly, his unwavering commitment to his faith and his family, who, as we all know, served as the foundation that allowed, supported, and encouraged Mayor Clay to answer his calling to be a truly dedicated and public life servant. On a personal note, upon assuming the office of mayor, one of his earliest acts was to present Pete Biskowski's father, Johnny V., a former mayor himself of Gary, Indiana, with a key to this great city. That evening, that sentiment, that gesture will be forever remembered by Johnny V., by Pete Biskowski, and by his family. But this is just one example of Mayor Clay's kindness to his fellow citizens. Mayor Clay was always motivated by a hopeful enthusiasm and optimism for his fellow citizens of Gary, of Lake County, of the state of Indiana, and of our nation. He believed that great things could be accomplished by investing in the greatest resource we have in Northwest Indiana. That would not be our land, air, or water, but it would be the people of Northwest Indiana. And by investing in the people, by helping the people, great things can be accomplished, nothing is impossible, and good things will happen. For those that do not know, in 1976, Pete Biskowski, as a young campaign staffer for former Representative Adam Benjamin, had the opportunity to begin a working relationship with Mayor Rudy Clay. Throughout the years, Pete Piskulski enjoyed the opportunity to grow that friendship and grow that working relationship, culminating in 2008, when, not only as mayor of this great city, but as Lake County Democratic Chairman, Mayor Rudy Clay led the charge to help President Barack Obama become the first Democratic presidential nominee to win this great state of Indiana since 1964. But in closing, Mayor Clay loved his politics, but he loved the people he represented more. He made a promise to the people that he loved so very much that he would do his very best each and every day to support the people, to help the people, and to create opportunities in our communities. With his passing, Pete is confident that through the many lives he touched throughout his lifetime, that his work will continue, that the cause that he most cared about, to help people in Northwest Indiana, will not be left undone. Thank you very much.
Someone said, like, I don't need this. I'm going to try it anyway. To the clergy, elected officials, dais guests, all of us lovers of Rudy Clay, especially Chris and Sporty. I've spent the past week smiling through my tears. Every time I become sad, I think of lighter moments. And I thank God and Rudy for that. Rudy and I have been lifelong friends, same neighborhood growing up, and I was reflecting upon the statement that was made about his rock throwing on 26th and Polk. I used to have to go to a grocery store in that area, and so I learned how to duck those rocks too. Went to the same high school, the Mighty Belt. I came out a year before, yeah. I see Dr. Smith frowning. I preceded Rudy in the class of 1952. He came out in 53. We wound up at the same university, Indiana University, and, you know, I became a successor to the Senate seat, where he was the first to hold that office, African-American to hold that office. No wonder we worked so well together. We really clicked when he became mayor. And I was reflecting on that with some of the staff, Thalia and Claire, others. And I could tell you a lot of stories about Rudy and his visits to the State House. And I got a note from a state worker just this last week, Monday, in fact, wishing me well and writing, "I remember him as a sharp dresser whose presence was felt when he visited the State House. That presence was no more evident than when I introduced him to Governor Mitch Daniels. And I wonder now, how is a conservative millionaire Republican and a liberal, humble beginning Democrat, how are they going to get along? Well, they interacted like old friends. The governor commenting on Rudy's monogram shirt cuffs and later presented him with an Indiana tie. That meeting was the beginning of a mutual respect and working relationship that helped Gary through some of its toughest financial challenges. And whenever I'd run into the governor in the State House, he'd ask, how's Rudy? I finally came to the conclusion that if you didn't like Rudy, then something is wrong with you. In closing, let me share my most memorable moment with working with Rudy. And it was the primary election that was spoken of earlier in 2008. I was the district campaign coordinator for Barack Obama, and Rudy was the Lake County chairman. So you remember Rudy and Mayor McDermott's encounter on national television? Well, I got a call from Barack's state chair, a guy named Kipper II, and he was in a panic. Earlene, what's Rudy doing? I replied, I don't know. So I called Rudy, who was in Crown Point, where the votes were being tallied. Rudy's reply was, I'm waiting for Gary's votes, because those votes were going to be the votes that are going to give Indiana, give Barack Obama the win in Indiana. Gary was always uppermost in Rudy's mind and heart. But you know, that decision, that delay, was a turning point in Obama's win for the presidency, orchestrated by one of the finest political minds this area has ever witnessed. I mentioned when I started about my seesaw with tears and smiles. So in closing, let me share some of the words of a song that keeps going through my mind that they're playing on a lot of the stations. Take me to the King. Can't sing, so let me just give you a few of the words. I don't have much to bring. My heart is my offering. And I'm just thinking with Rudy's big heart, those pearly gates will open wide, and he will be welcome. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon. First off, to the members of the clergy, I bring you greetings from Northside New Era Missionary Baptist Church in Indianapolis, where Reverend Clarence Moore is my shepherd and my leader. My name is Robin Winston. I had the distinct honor of serving as the chairman of the Indiana Democratic Party from 1999 until 2001. I was succeeded by my friend Peter Manos, who's here today, because he always told me Lake County mattered, and I always remembered that Lake County did. Rudy Clay, Mrs. Clay, was committed to this community. You have heard this from countless people today, but I can tell you firsthand that he probably knows every rest stop along I-65 between here and Indianapolis. He knew every place to stop and get something to eat. He knew, Sheriff, where the state troopers are. He knew every nook and cranny about I-65. He truly was the man in drive on I-65 coming back and forth to Indiana. Rudy Clay was a leader. There's no doubt about that. But Rudy Clay was a leader that embodied a spirit that said, if you lived on Van Buren or 15th, you mattered as much to him as if you ate at Gamba in Merrillville or walked around downtown Indianapolis or walked the halls of power in Washington, D.C. He never overlooked anyone. Anyone. And when I would look at my phone and I would see 219-765-5950, I knew that that was Rudy Clay calling. And he wasn't calling asking for tickets to something. He was calling because, in this case, he wanted 34 new firefighters back here in Gary. And he worked with us and worked with Mark Lopez and Congressman Visklosky and members of your General Assembly delegation and with you. And then Chief Williamson to make sure we got those firefighters back on the job. And when he called, he was talking about making sure that somebody wrote a letter of support for $225 million of improvements at U.S. Steel. Not because of Rudy Clay, but because he wanted to make sure people had good jobs. Rudy Clay was always, always somebody that put the common good of others before himself. He was excited about giving a kid a bike at Santa's event for kids that Santa forgot. He was excited about getting a ramp built for a senior citizen outside their home. And he was absolutely excited whenever he would talk about being back in Gary and when people would come to Gary to see his town. Mrs. Clay, your husband was young at heart. He was the first techno geek that I ever knew. He had a Palm and a BlackBerry and a Droid. He had them before Verizon even got them on the counter. And I don't know how this would happen, but I would go home after meeting Rudy Clay, and I'd take my coat off, and I'd reach inside my pocket, and there would be a Rudy Clay bookmark somehow inside my coat pocket. In fact, this morning when I got up, I put on my suit, and amazingly appeared a City of Gary button that says Rudy Clay Mayor. I don't know how that happened, but he was a master of marketing your city. You know, Alex Haley, the author of Roots, once said that history is written by the winners. History is written by the winners. And I was in Indianapolis on the set of a television show on election night, in November of 2008. And I can tell you the eyes of the entire country were on Gary, Indiana. They were on Gary, Indiana. And who was on television election night talking about Gary, Indiana? To national reporters, but Rudy Clay. So while Barack Obama may have run for president, it was you and Rudy Clay who made him president. Mrs. Clay, your husband was a gem. And I am very honored to be part of an effort right now to memorialize his efforts at the State Museum in Indianapolis. Your members of the General Assembly who are here and Senator Rogers know all too well that it is the Indiana State Museum in Indianapolis, but there are very few people that look like us in the Indiana State Museum. So because of our work and because of his leadership and because of your support, there will be an exhibit there that will talk about Indiana history. And there will be an exhibit there that will highlight what Rudy Clay has done for the people of Gary and for the people of Indiana. There is an old saying that says that you make a living by what you get, but you make a life by what you give. We were blessed. Rudy Clay was not only a friend, he was a mentor, he was a politician, but now he is on his way to look down from above and know that he gave a lot. And he knows, as 2 Timothy says, that he fought the good fight, that he finished the race, and that he had faith in the end. And with knowing that, we will always remember the works and the deeds of Rudy Clay. Thank you very much.
I was very sad when I heard of the passing of Rudy. He touched so many people's lives and helped so many people in so many different ways. He was truly the people's champion because he truly cared about all of us, and he naturally cared about us. It was an intuitive love that Rudy had for all of us. I've known Rudy most of my life. I can remember when my father purchased our funeral home from Mr. Guy, and he was having trouble getting insurance on the vehicles, our ambulance and our limousines, because during that period it was very difficult for a black businessman to get insurance, business insurance. And Rudy came to our rescue. Rudy saved the day for our funeral home because it would have been impossible for us to operate an ambulance service in the funeral home without insurance for our vehicles. Incidentally, during the period that Rudy was an insurance agent, he and Commissioner Jerry Shoup, their lives were intertwined. Commissioner Shoup and Rudy were insurance agents together at Prudential Insurance. And it's a funny thing how the Lord affects our individual lives and set our destinies. Who would have imagined that that Jerry Shoup and Rudy Clay would have had such successful political careers, and both ended up working together as county commissioners. Rudy as the North County Commissioner and Jerry Shoup as the South County Commissioner. You know, I can remember as an undergraduate student at Howard University back in the late 60s, shortly after Reverend Martin Luther King was assassinated. And quite naturally, I was angry and frustrated and disappointed. Who pops up? Rudy Clay. He comes to Washington as part of that Poor People's Campaign. They came down, Rudy and my cousin Dozier, Allen, former Mayor Richard Gordon Hatcher. They came to Washington, and they came down to protest poverty. Even at that time, before Rudy had become an elected official, a public official, he was already fighting and marching for the rights of poor people. They set up a tent city down there in Washington for about 6 weeks. I can remember Rudy as a consummate candidate, consummate public official, very clever. I had the opportunity to run against Rudy in an election. It was the most difficult election of my life. You know, I've been a public official for about 30 years. That was the most difficult, election of my life. And I thought, well, I'm much younger than Rudy. I can wear him down. Bad mistake. Yeah. This fella had overwhelming energy. He would never stay still. I was never at home. I was always out campaigning, trying to keep up with Rudy. And you have automobiles. The automobiles, you have a first gear, second gear, third gear. But Rudy had fourth, fifth, and sixth gears in his engine, and I sent my scouts out, and we found out that that at that time Rudy was eating a lot of tomatoes. And so I said, well, maybe it's in the tomatoes, maybe that's where he's getting all of this energy. So, and I went on the internet and read up on tomatoes and found out about the lycopene in the tomatoes and stuff. And so all of a sudden, I'm eating all of these tomatoes. I'm stopping everywhere at restaurants. On their appetizers on their menus was the risotto, the tomatoes. And I'm eating the tomatoes, trying to get the kind of energy that Rudy had, because Rudy was running me in the ground. I mean, no one was happier than I when Rudy decided that he wanted to become the mayor of Gary. I was the happiest person in the entire United States. I went home and I got on my knees and I said a long prayer to God, thanking him that Rudy had decided to become the mayor of Gary. Rudy was a public official for 39 years, but 30 of those years were spent as a public official with the county. So Rudy belongs to us. I mean, he was the mayor for a little while. He was a state senator. He was this. He was that. Rudy belongs to county government. I just want to get that understanding. And not only does Rudy belong to county government, Mrs. Clay, Christine, she belongs to county government. Mrs. Clay has been with county government for about 20 years, it's my understanding. And both of them have served in their capacity as county officials to help all of the citizens, to help all of us, to help enhance our quality of life, to make life easier for us. Every time you go to the gas pump and you pump gas, which is over $4 a gallon, you want to make absolutely certain that you're getting your money's worth. Well, you should thank Mrs. Clay. Every time you go to a supermarket or a store and you purchase meat and they put your meat on that scale and you want to make sure you're getting the right quantity of meat for the money that you're paying, you need to thank Mrs. Clay. You know, we talked about Rudy's people skills. We talked about how much he loves people and how much he's done for people. But, you know, we never talked about his accomplishments. Rudy had a lot of accomplishments, and most of his accomplishments were in county government. And I'll mention some of the larger projects that occurred while Rudy was there. During Rudy's term of office as a county government official, the county created the tax increment financing district out there on US 30 and put the infrastructure in for all of those stores you see out there, the box stores, the retail stores, the mall, the hotels, all of that commercial development out there. Rudy Clay had something to do with that, and I think you should know it, you know, because we talk about Rudy liking people, but Rudy not only liked people, Rudy did a whole lot for us. Under Rudy's watch, the county jail was built, a new, brand new county jail, and that was a massive undertaking. That was one of the larger projects in the county. Also, there was a county juvenile center that was built under Rudy's watch while Rudy was county commissioner. So I think it's important that you know that there were a lot of accomplishments that he had during his life. I'd like to say Rudy is probably the only public official that knew all of his employees personally. And then there are a lot of employees in the county government. I discovered that there are 1,800. I think when Rudy was commissioner, there were almost 2,000 employees. And Rudy knew them, and he not only knew the employees, he knew their families. And so that's a tremendous feat for a person to have. I mean, you talk about a person's character and you talk about agape love and the love that a person has for the people around him. He had a tremendous love for people, you know, and I have to congratulate Mrs. Clay, because the way he was out among the people, he couldn't have spent a whole lot of time. You had to sacrifice a lot of the time that you would normally have with your husband. You had to share him. You had to share him with the general public. And that takes an extremely strong woman. Now, finally, I'd like for the county officials who are present to stand. I have a commemorative plaque that I'd like to read from the county government. So I'd like the county officials to stand. We have our prosecutor, we have our judges, we have our recorder, our commissioner, we have our clerk, we have the sheriff, we have the treasurer, and I think our auditor is here, and we have our surveyor. So we have a good representation of our county officials present. This plaque commemorating the life of Rudy Clay Sr. reads as follows: Whereas Rudy Clay Sr. served citizens in elected official capacity for 39 consecutive years over 4 decades, and we verified the time period with the election board. And whereas Rudy Clay Sr. during this period served as an Indiana senator, a Lake County council person, a Lake County recorder, a Lake County commissioner, and mayor of the city of Gary, and whereas no person has served the citizens of the city of Gary, the county of Lake, the state of Indiana, for a longer period in more capacities than Rudy Clay Sr. And whereas the focus of his political career was always the people he served and discovering ways in which their problems could be addressed and solved. Now, therefore, the Board of Commissioners, the county of Lake, hereby commemorates and honors the life of Rudy Clay Sr., which was a model for all those who seek to serve others in an elected political position. And it's signed by myself, Commissioner Mike Repe, and our Commissioner Jerry Hsu. And finally, on behalf of all the county officials and our employees. We want to offer our sincere sympathy to Mrs. Clay and to the Clay family, and to indicate to Mrs. Clay that you are one of our own also. We're going to miss Rudy. Even though Rudy was mayor, he spent a large part of his time at the county because he knew that's where he actually belonged. That's where, that was his home. That was his home base. That was his extended family. And so we simply want to extend our sympathy. Thank you.
First, giving honor to God, who's the head of my life, to the clergy that are present, and of course my minister, the Reverend Ferris D. Evans, to the family and friends of Rudy Clay, my friend. Rudy and I had a special friendship. Did we fight, yeah? I'd call up John or either Roosevelt and say, well, I done made Rudy mad again. First thing would ask me, what did you do this time? So this particular time I have to tell you about, Rudy and I were sitting in the living room at my house, and he was telling me about all the things that he wanted to accomplish for the city of Gary. So he talked about the Sheridan. I said, Rudy, why do you want to mess with that Sheridan as ragged and roaded out as it is? He said, well, see, I said, we're going to fix that up. I said, yeah. I said, but Rudy, you could build a new one. I said, just call them folk out there in Las Vegas and tell them to come and go boom. Well, I shouldn't have said that. And I didn't know it upset him like that until one day I was talking to Roosevelt. He said, you know Rudy upset with you about talking about going boom. I said, is he mad for real? He said, yes, he is. I said, okay, I got to call him. So I called him. I said, you coming by this way? I need to talk to you because I got to apologize. But Rudy and I had a friendship that was so unique to me. My husband never went into the hospital, no matter what hospital he was in, that Rudy didn't go to see him. I walked into, I don't know how he got in intensive care, but he did. So when I got in there, that was one of the cards on the table. So I said to him, I said, you know Rudy been here? He said, no, I must have been asleep. He was asleep, but he left his card to make sure, with his picture on it, mind you, to let him know that he had been there. And the same with me. He was truly a friend. For those of you who did not know that soft side of Rudy, he was not a, let's say, he was a humble person, really. Rudy would sit back, and what he would say to me is, because I was flashing hot-headed, he said, don't ever let him see you sweat. He said, what you do is beat him at the game, and I'm going to show you how. And it was all about politics. Rudy knew how to campaign when everybody else was asleep. We would ride and get in them living rooms. That's how he won, Karen. He knew what to do. And I was privileged. And I must say, it was a privilege to ride along with him, for him to show me the way. When I went out to Lake County, it was not just because my name was Elsa Franklin. There was two men at that particular time pushing that endeavor. And now, today, both of them are no longer here. And that was Rudy Clay and Stephen R. Stiglitz. That's how I got to Lake County. And I worked. And I'll never, ever forget the days that Rudy and I would sit in my living room and talk about everything. And people in this community, please. please remember and understand, Rudy loved the city. He not only loved the city, he loved the people in it. He was very, very passionate and sincere about how he felt and what he wanted to accomplish. I just hate that he became the mayor of the city when there was no money to do the kinds of things that he wanted to do. But rest assured, ladies and gentlemen, had it been here, all those things that Rudy talked about, it would have been accomplished, because that's what he wanted to do. A couple of days, and I shared this with Roosevelt. 2 or 3 days ago, I got a phone call about 8:30 in the morning, and there was this young lady on the phone that used to be a neighbor of mine and a very good friend of my children. And she was just booing. Now I'm trying to figure, oh, my God, what has happened to her or one of her children? She said to me, would you please tell Mrs. Clay that Mayor Clay gave my son the very first bicycle that he ever had in life. And she said when she came down here for the tours that Santa forgot, so she was standing there and the baby was just booing and just crying his heart out. So Rudy told her, you go home and tomorrow morning you're going to have that bicycle. The very next day, that child had that bicycle along with numerous other toys. His best friend had taken the bike, and so while he was there, he took a look around. He went back and told Rudy, they need some furniture too. Ladies and gentlemen, they got that furniture because he made it possible. The senior citizens in this community, Rudy, generally, and the handicapped, he loved them. I looked up one day, Thalia, on the phone, and whatever Commissioner Clay said, you can message to, it was going to be carried out, because Thalia was going to carry it out. So she called me on the phone, and she says, the mayor wants to meet with the precinct committeeman. I was not city chair at that time. And I said, okay, what is this about, Thalia? Well, he didn't tell me. So me and Shirley Bynum and several others that he invited to the meeting, we met on Grant Street. He talked about how many phone calls that he had received for the handicapped. Rudy happened to be out campaigning, and he ran into this young lady that was carrying her mother on her back down to the handicapped bus because she didn't have a ramp. Well, Rudy made sure that we started rolling out and started begging. I'm telling you, he could make us beg good, okay? He would have us look doing all the things that we needed to be doing as elected officials to stand beside him and help him do the things that he loved to do for his people. And he made sure when he got a phone call after seeing that lady and her daughter carrying her, just literally carrying her on her back, and she had to do that in order for her to go to dialysis. He started building those ramps, and from that day to this, 3 or 4 weeks before Rudy passed, one of the precinct committee persons called me about a ramp. I called Rudy. He said, well, we got to find somebody to build those ramps, Elsa, because the man that did them is no longer with us. So then I started looking around to try to find that ramp, someone to build that ramp. Unfortunately, she passed before we could get someone to build that ramp. But that's the heart of the man that I knew and loved as a friend, Rudy Clay. Chris, it has been echoed to you all day long, but I want you to know We appreciate the sacrifices as a wife. Rudy Jr., the same goes to you for your dad. Because many, many, many days, Rudy would be out there doing what he had to do for the people. And that's a sacrifice. When every time when you get ready to sit down at the table and your husband is not there because he's out doing God's work. Rudy was just not a politician. Rudy was a servant. And he served this community with dignity and pride. And for that, we will always love and miss you, my friend. But I'm going to tell you all something before I leave. Rudy is up there right now looking at us. And he's smiling, just as happy as he can be, with his tailored robe on, with his initials on the cuffs. And he's having a good time. Thank you.
Amen. The Honorable Rudolph Rudy Clay, truly a good man, an awesome man, a man of integrity, a servant leader. And I can imagine that as he fought those last days that he looked up and said, all in his hands, and he gave it over to the Lord. And now we will have a musical selection from the Gary Community Choir, All in His Hands. put it all in his hands. At this time, we will have Rudy Clay Jr. come and offer words from the heart.
Ooh. Wow. Can you hear me? Okay. This is probably the most difficult thing I had to do in my life, is to stand here at the funeral of my dad. So just kind of bear with me. I don't want to choke up on anyone. But like my dad always started off, I just want to thank God for being God. Thank God for God. And I want to thank God for my mom and my dad. And I just love my dad so much, and it just hurts so much, and it's just so hard to stand here, you know. But I am my father's son, and I wanted to share with you what people have said may make me feel better, is to remember all the good times that my dad and I had. I know I really want to thank each and every one of you for showing your love and your condolences and your comments, and so much love has poured into my mom and I. It has made me feel a lot better, because it was pretty rough the first couple of days. But people speak of my father and his bookmarks in his pocket. Well, he used to use some of those bookmarks to write his notes on. And he would go into his pocket and he would have his bookmarks. And I found a bookmark of one of his last notes that really touched my heart, and I just wanted to read it to everybody. And this was a few months before his transition. It says, "Storms will come, dark and sun, but look to God." The second quote was, "All your strength is gone, look to God, be strong." The next quote he wrote on here is, "Smile, laugh, good looking to God." And then he said, "Lift your head and look to Jesus." So this is something I wanted to pass on to you guys. One thing that he taught me through his example was his love and commitment. Everybody liked my father because everybody likes to hang with someone with integrity, that they can trust, that they knew was kosher, that they knew was honest. That's why people respected my father and hung with my father. There was one time a newspaper made a mistake and printed that my father took $1,000 bribe. Normally people would say, "They finally got Rudy." But guess what people were doing? They were betting each other that he didn't take the money, which was true because they knew his character. So that's what made my father such a great man, and that's what he instilled in me, was the integrity. One thing that proved that is when he was 18 months old, he came to Gary from my Aunt Lucy, which I call Grandma Hunter, and my Aunt Daisy. And from that day, he never left or moved out of Gary. And he stayed in Gary for the rest of his life. That was true commitment. Another thing that showed my father's real commitment and loyalty. When he was a little boy, my Grandma Hunter and Aunt Daisy took him to Israel CME Church when he was real little. and he was baptized there, and he became a member there, and he stayed with that one church for the rest of his life. Another thing that really touches my heart, and I just thank God that I had the greatest dad and mom, or the greatest example, was he found the love of his life, my mom, and he stayed with her for the rest of his life. Even when he became a public servant at the United Viscounts, giving out hundreds of bread baskets and groceries to people, he stayed a public servant for the rest of his life. So that was just such a great example for me, and a great, great thing that I just cherished, that my dad, I didn't even realize when he was my dad that it was like that until Toya told me. I remember we were in the house on 10th and Lane, and my mother was getting on my dad's case. And she can get on my dad's case now. And boy, my father stood up. He said, "You got the best husband and you got the best son. You got the best husband in the world. You got the best son in the world, and I'm through with it." And he walked out into the bedroom. And me and Toy was like, "Whoa, my dad is, you know, he tripping." But you know, I didn't understand his level of understanding and commitment to what he was saying, and everything he was saying was true. You know, that he really meant that. And when I saw my mom and my dad's wedding pictures before I was born, he was just so happy with my mother. And then when I looked at the wedding, the 50th anniversary wedding pictures with my mother, he was just so happy with my mother, the same spirit. And that really touched my heart to know that I had a great dad.
Oh, boy.
When I was growing up, all my friends and I was so proud of my dad, because I say my dad is so cool. He was the coolest dude, boy. I mean, if you look into the program and see him with that hat on, that's when he was state senator and had a red and white limousine. Have you ever seen one since? You can't get no cooler than that. And everybody said, "Boy, your dad's so cool." And I was just so happy. My father's so cool. You know, but he had always had a heart of gold. He was just so precious, precious, precious. And one other thing I would like to say, and my memories of good memories with my dad, I did not know how talented he was in other things. You know, he was a cross-country runner in high school, which I didn't know. So I used to run, and I would run for like miles without getting winded. So I thought that I can outrun my dad. And I wanted to race him from 11th and Roosevelt to 11th and Grant to Mr. Lucky's. And boy, he let me. And back then, it was the middle way was kind of like the Zodiac building, the Perilous. And boy, I was running. I got up to the Zodiac. I was dusting my father. He was like, "Boy, before I got to the alley of the 11th Avenue, my father shot past me, boy." And I was like, "What?" So then I learned how to swim. And I just love swimming. And I say, "Dad, I can beat you swimming, you know." And we was at this Olympic-sized pool. And he said, "Go." And boy, I jumped in there and I was swimming my heart out. And my father swam the whole length of the pool underwater. Just to show me he the man. So I really appreciate what he have showed me. He instilled integrity into me when I didn't even know that there was shysters and con men and all that. I never lived that way because of my dad. And I know when Mr. Allen was talking about keeping up with my dad, I was talking to Roosevelt, and Roosevelt said, "Man, we had three shifts for your dad." He said, "I do that morning shift, then I have to go take a nap. Then we have to get John, and then John had to go take a nap. Then we had, and then we go get Yancey." I mean, he was saying that my father had three shifts because they just couldn't keep up with him. And I'm just honored and privileged and so thankful to have the best dad in the world, you know. And in closing, another thing he was saying in politics, I used to say, "Hey, everybody's getting these billboards, my dad's opponents." And I would say, "Wow, they billboards all over." And my dad said, "You know what? Billboards don't vote. The people vote." Yeah. And one last thing, this picture on the program, I believe this captures the essence of my father's spirit. He was a nice dude. He didn't talk bad about anybody. He didn't drink and smoke and get high and stay out all night. And he just loved his family. And at the end of the day, his last few days, he just wanted his family. And I'm just so honored that my mom and there was with them, and I'll miss my dad forever, and it's just so hard, and I just want to thank each and every one of you for coming out. Thank you very much.
We will now have remarks from Reverend Marion J. Johnson, Jr. of Mount Moriah Missionary Baptist Church. Following that, Bishop E. Bobby Warren of Deliverance Temple Church of God in Christ, Roosevelt Powell, a special friend, and then following Mr. Powell is John McLeod, special friend.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Welch, to Pastor George, who's Elder George, who will be preaching this service. I hope we pray for her because she's been sitting here a long time. Amen. To our mayor, to our fellow pastors and ministers, all the elected officials, and the remainder of my brothers and sisters in Christ, and especially to the Clay family today. Amen. Mrs. Clay, Rudy Clay Jr., and all those that make up this tremendous family. When I got the call that Mayor Clay had been called home by the Lord, I never called him Rudy. I've always called him, whatever office he held, that's what I would give him his title. For the Bible says to give honor where honor is due, tribute where tribute is due. So when I was called by Mayor Clay about his going home, it was shocking to me. I want to talk as a friend, because he was truly my friend. Many of you don't know the relationship that I have with him. I've been knowing him ever since I was a little boy. We had a peculiar relationship. We would meet each other in restaurants sometimes. And he would say, "Pastor Johnson, why are you always eating in restaurants?" I say, "Well, my cook's on about a 25-year leave, amen." And I noticed how he loved being in restaurants. And I found out it wasn't about the soup, because he would always find out who had the best soup in town. But with him, it was because he had a chance to share with the people of this community. He had a chance to tell somebody hello, had a chance to pay for somebody's dinner. That was his way of communicating. When his son just mentioned about billboards don't vote, I believe it wasn't about him running all the time. I believe it was about him just strictly loving people. If there was nobody else in the world that loves people, Mayor Rudy Clay loved people. Amen. Come on, give it up for him. Amen. And then when you think about the many, many accomplishments that he had, the Bible says in Psalms 90 and 12, so teach us to number our days that we might apply our hearts unto wisdom. You can hold a doctor's degree, you can finish first in every class that you ever attended, but if you don't have wisdom, if we don't have wisdom, we still don't have anything. He was a man that took the things that he knew from the church, Sunday school, from going to Roosevelt High School, from going up and down 25th Avenue, where we used to watch them go up and down 25th Avenue. They were the big boys, we were the little boys. And all those things that he experienced in life, he put them together. And I believe in my spirit, he said, Lord, give me wisdom. And because God gave him that wisdom, we are witnesses of the wisdom that was given to him here today. Amen. As I go to my seat, in Deuteronomy, it says that Moses drawed out into the dark, and there's where he found God. Mrs. Clay, is going to be some dark time. Rudy Jr., there's still going to be some dark times. Family and all of us that are sitting here, I don't care how holy you are, how saved you are, there's some dark times in this earth. For the Bible says that in this world you shall have trials and tribulations. But he says to be of good cheer because I have overcome the world. I lost a ring one time in my room and the lights was off. Looked all over for the ring, and not that I was materialistic, but it was my ring and I wanted to find it. So I tried looking around for the ring and I found out I had to turn on the lights. But when you're looking for God, amen, he can be found in the darkness. He can be found in the darkness of heartache. He can be found in the darkness of loneliness. Remember, Mrs. Clay, Rudy Clay Jr., this entire family, that God can be found in the dark.
I'm grateful to be here this morning to the Honorable Karen Freeman Wilson, to the officiant, to the pastors present, to the dignitaries and public servants, and especially to Miss Clay and the family. I want you to know I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Miss Clay and the entire family, I want you to know, you see, talk is cheap, but it takes money to buy a house and a car. You can count on my prayers and my condolences that come from the heart. I'm thankful and humble for the privilege to express my heartfelt condolences in the time of this homegoing of my lifelong friend, Mayor Rudy Clay. We were raised up on the same street, 26 and Polk, about three houses apart, and he got a chance to hear a lot of things about God from me as well, because my father was a founding preacher. We went to the same school, as Senator Rogers said, same school. I heard heard her say that she had graduated in 52. Mayor Clay graduated in 53. And I brought up the rear 1954. In our childhood days, we called him Toons. I tried to look up the meaning of truth because names have a meaning. And I couldn't find the name. Tombstone. The reason why, I suppose, because he was so unique. I was called Bobby. And I love my childish name, and I wear it even today. I heard his son say what a good runner he was. And on Polk Street, we was coming up about 8 years, nine, and he and I was from 8 years up. And he was that good runner. And my legs were short. We would play and run the game called drop hands and run. And when we drop hands and run, you have to catch everybody. And I would be the first one caught. He will still be running. Many said that to me, and I don't know why, say, you look just like the mayor. And some would say, hi, mayor. I said, I'm not the mayor, I'm Bishop Warren. And so I told him one day, I said, Mayor Clay, you got to give me some bodyguards so I can live a long time. I can still reflect and remember that God given him blessed days that we shared in life. I could envision then he was destined for greatness because of his congeniality and his tenacity. He was a consummate public servant. He was extraordinary politician, and assured the citizens of the community and the citizens of Gary that he and his fidelity and their cause and need from him was authentic. For years, his presence and voice was a highlight in many of my jurisdictional diocese convention. We could expect his presence in church services, family reunions, banquets, weddings, appreciation service, being there for the senior citizen and the children, if you have heard before, that Santa forgot. That was part of his unique campaign style that propelled him into greatness. He liked one of the quotes of the late President Kennedy. He would say, ask not what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country. And certainly when he arose to the height of mayor of the city of Gary, he knew that you needed to do something for your city. I could always admire his love for God, and by the way he began his addresses, by saying, to God be the glory. And I wanted to know what that meant. It meant everything done for God's glory and to the exclusion of mankind, self-glorification, and pride. Over and beyond the multiple political seats and positions that he successfully run and held. Running for a seat in God's kingdom was his ultimate goal. In that race, he didn't retire. He never stopped running. And for that cause, and the reason for that, his heart was fixed, and his mind was made up. I had a television cast made in my church, one of my conventions, and I said, oh, I'm going to really enjoy this telecast after it's over because I can view the tape. And when I got the tape, the camera was up high, all in the ceiling, all over in the corner, and I was wondering why was the camera all, where was his mind? And I thought, well, he videoed what his mind told him. Your mind got to be set. And your mind got to be focused. My friend made the good choices. And I'm honored that I was raised up from about 8 years old up until present. He took the road of being an astute, effective politician. And I took the way of being a servant of God. Being a servant of God, I must say that we have a unique legacy from my friend and your friend to cherish. May I say also to my friend, Sister Clay, I just believe, like Paul, that your husband fought a good fight.
Ow!
That's my preaching voice, I'm sorry. He finished his course, and he kept the faith. That goal and prize is the eternal life, our heavenly home. It's a better place. No more hurt. No more sickness. No more sorrow. No more crying. No more dying. You can rest assured you have the comfort of God. And in my closing, like David, one of the greatest writers in the Bible, he said this, lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. The question was asked, who is the King of glory? He is the Lord.
Ow!
The Hebiah. He is the Lord, strong and mighty. He's mighty in battle. Sister Clay, and to this family, God is with you. So lift up your head. You had a great, great servant, a great husband. We'll miss him. But God willing, we're not in a hurry, but we hope to see him in the morning.
Good morning. Give honor to the Honorable Mayor Karen Freeman Wilson, all the clergy and all the elected officials, and to Rudy and Chris, I love you. Rudy and I were good friends, and a lot of things that the people were talking about, Rudy had secrets, and the secret was how he did the politics. John was the technical man. Yancey was the speaker. And they called me. I was the one to bring everything to the finish line. And then later on, we brought on a guy. We had to, in politics, you argue with a lot of people and things of that nature. So we had to bring on another guy later on in the campaign. Was Nate Williams, and he was the peacemaker. because in politics, you argue a lot with different people, but Rudy always says, no permanent enemies and no permanent friends. And as Rudy Clay Jr. said was that we did have to run three shifts on Rudy because he would wear everybody down. And I take, like Rudy said, I take the first shift. Then John take the second shift, Yancey take the third shift. And then we all come back at night. I look up for John and Yancey, they somewhere asleep. Then I had to come back on the next shift. Another thing, too, was that Rudy did, with his, we had a thing with the toys for kids, the ramps, and things of that nature. But there's one other thing that he did that most people don't know. For 20 years, we gave away Christmas baskets, over thousands of baskets for people. We had cooks that takes care of and bang bags of things up, of things of that nature. And another thing, too, that we did was Rudy had only in Gary, not only in Gary did he take care of people with Toys for Kids for Santa Forgot, but a young lady in University of Chicago named Edna, she told me to give her regards to you, Chris. She had about 30 kids that we took care of on the south side of Chicago. We took care of those kids, too. And another thing in politics, Mr. Allen, why you couldn't beat Rudy was that we had the best absentee person. We had 500 soldiers from the Freedom House. And then we had assembly line of taking care of the literature at someone's house. I remember one day we had about 100,000 pieces of literature. So Chris say, "You gonna get that? How y'all gonna get that literature out?" And so we had the assembly line, the people folding the literature and everything. And lo and behold, Chris walked into the house to make sure we was doing the right thing. We love you for that, Chris, too, you know. And as I said before, and then we had a guy, I remember this, too. We had a friend of ours named, we called him Buzzard. So he needed a job. So I called Rudy. I said, "Rudy, man, we got to have a resume." He said, "Man, what did Buzz do?" I said, "Well, Buzz really didn't do anything, man." He said, "Well, we're going to make him a cook." So Rudy wrote him a resume, and we took Buzzard over to Lehman Brothers, sitting down with the guy at Lehman Brothers, man. And so while we were sitting there, Rudy said, "Wait a minute, Bill. I tell you what we're going to do. We're going to tell the man the truth." So we told the man the truth, and Buzzard ended up retiring from Lehman Brothers after 30 years. Rudy, I love you, man. I love you. Goodbye, my friend. I hope to see you again, but not soon, I hope. Another thing, too, Rudy loves Sunday school. And I look, some of the mornings I look outside, man, I said, "Man, I hope it's raining outside on Sunday." And all of a sudden, 7 o'clock in the morning, he called me, "Vel, get ready." And here come him and Stoner picking me up going to Sunday school. And Rudy loved, out of most of all his security guys, it was Stoner, because he said one thing. Stoner loved Sunday school too. And I remember one Sunday, the Sunday school teacher didn't show up. So it was me, Rudy, Stoner, and Tinsley, and some other people. So I said, "Man, who's going to teach Sunday school class?" I said, "Rudy, man, you got to teach Sunday school class." He said, "No." He's a belt. "You a jackleg preacher, you get up there and teach Sunday school." So he made me the sister Sunday school teacher. Rudy, I love you. And another thing, too, in politics, it was a thing where we had a guy, Buzzard was called a debater. So Rudy said, "Look, Vel," he put up some literature that we're going to put out. He said, "Look, man, call Buzz." So I called Buzz and give Buzz the literature. Buzz read the literature. Now we know what Buzz going to do. He's going to debate at Coney Island. He's going to take it up to Jonathan's and debate. So that way we get it all over the city for free. So as I say, Rudy, goodbye, my friend. and I hope to meet again. One thing, Rudy, you don't have to worry about. I'm going to Sunday school, so please don't come see me.
Good morning. The past few days have been very difficult for me. All of you know he was my best friend. I love him. He loved me. And I will miss him. To the fine pastors of Rudy's church, past and present, Pastor Welch, the Reverend George, and the CME family, all the clergy in attendance, Karen Freeman Wilson, elected officials, classmates, and friends of my best friend, and, of course, Christine, Spody, the Clay family, the Clay mates, past and present, and my friend Roosevelt. I want to thank the Hammer Times for the wonderful articles about my best friend. I want to thank all of you for the phone calls, the cards you have sent me on behalf of my best friend. And I want to thank the mayor of this fine city, Karen, for all the things she has done for Christine and family. And to the rest of you who have done something to ease the burden the last few days. The last few days I've asked myself a question. How do you say goodbye to someone you really, really love? How do you say goodbye? I know at some point in time, you just really have to say goodbye. But I ask the question, how do you say goodbye? How do you say goodbye to someone you have talked to the last 40 years or so, 3 times a day? Each conversation started with or ended with, "I love you, man." Has anyone told you they love you? How do you say goodbye? How do you say goodbye to someone who has loved your family the way they have loved their own? How do you say goodbye? A few years ago, Rudy came up with the slogan, "I care about people." He really did care about people. We were in Washington, D.C. to see Peter Bisgowski and Senator Richard Lugar found out we were in the area. He sent word, asked Rudy to stop by my office. We went in, we sat down, and we talked. He got up, and he went to his shelf, and he came back with a book of matches with Rudy's picture and the slogan, "I care about people." I said to myself, we have not used that kind of way to campaign in years. The matches must be old. He told Rudy, I changed things around on the shelf, but the matches always remain the same because I really believe you care about people. He told Rudy, I hear about all your great works. I only get one complaint. And Rudy, what's that? He said, they said, you only care about the people of Gary. How do you say goodbye? We were in Annapolis to see Lou Wallace and Theo Bowman play. The governor of the state came up. He and Rudy had a conversation. And to make a long story short, he told Rudy, being mayor of Gary is the toughest job in the state. And he smiled. And he said, maybe the country. But he told Rudy, you will be okay. You work hard for your people. He was really saying you care about people. You know, some people didn't like Rudy, and they didn't like his politics. Nothing personal, Michael Brown, but that's how it is in politics. They would tell me, John, I don't like your friend. I don't like him. And I don't like his politics. And I would smile because the key words were, I know that's your best friend. And that made me happy. I want the world to know that was my best friend. In politics, there are three kinds of people. Those on your left, those on your right, and those in the center. In the case of Rudy, you had people on the left. I like Rudy. I like this politics. And he couldn't do anything wrong. Then you have those on the right. They didn't like Rudy. They didn't like his politics. And he couldn't do anything right. Then in the middle, you have those people. They do not have an axe to grind. They love you if you serve. They love you if you respond to their needs. They love you if you are accessible, and they love you if you are honest. Those people in the center, they like Rudy. I know they like Rudy, and I'm going to tell you why. They like Rudy because they made him the first African-American senator. They made him a county councilman. They made him the first African-American recorder. He was your commissioner for 20 years and your mayor for a short time until the Lord stepped into the picture. Who knows, he might still be serving. How do you say goodbye? Rudy loved the CME Church. He loved the members. He loved his Sunday school. everywhere we would go, he encouraged people to come to Sunday school. And I say, Rudy, people have their own Sunday school to attend. He said, Big John, I'm just trying. That's all. He supported all of the clergy in the city of Gary, financially and otherwise. We were at a Catholic church in East Chicago, Indiana. They had recently had an earthquake. And so we went to the church, and the priest asked everyone to march around and put some money in the tray. So when Rudy marched around, he didn't put his in the tray. He put two checks in the priest's hand, and his eyes lit up. And so after we had gotten back to our seats, he prayed on the money, and he said, we will let the commissioner say a few words. Now, when we first got in there, he said, no speeches. So, I guess, clergy, sometimes $1,000 will make you change your mind. Well, Christine, it's time to say goodbye to my buddy. Rudy, I don't have to worry about answering any more questions about you and your Hummer. Goodbye. I don't have to listen to any more lies about you living in the city of Gary. Goodbye. I don't even have to explain to people you aren't going to be indicted. You aren't going to jail. And I will always remember going to the Chicago Bulls games, you, Roosevelt and myself, in the skybox, wonderful food, and watching you trying to eat a taffy apple and a brownie and ice cream at the same time. I miss you, Rudy. Good night, and I'll see you on the other side. Thank you.
We will now have a moment to reflect as we read the obituary silently. As one of Mayor Clay's favorite songs, I Look to You by Whitney Houston is played.
Thank you.
We will now have a musical selection. I want to say thank you by Reverend Ferris Evans Jr. Following that, the eulogy by Reverend Dr. S.C. Clark George, presiding elder of the Gary District of the Third Episcopal District of the Christian Methodist Episcopal Church.
On last Thursday, I got a phone call that was both bitter and sweet. This program has been put together, and a lot of great people have talked and sang. But the reason I'm most proud is that I got word that Mayor Rudy Clay put me on program. And I thank God for having a song that, other than my father, no one has promoted this more than Mayor Rudy Clay. Everywhere he's gone, he always ended by saying, "I want to say thank you." Muhammad Ali had what's the promoter with the hair? Muhammad Ali had Don King, but I had Mayor Rudy Clay, and I thank God for that. And let me say, as I'm only going to sing a piece of it. The song contains a line that says, "The China Wall." And Mayor Clay, he went to China, and he brought me back a piece of the China Wall. Now, I'm so privileged to now sing Mayor Clay's song, "I Want to Say Thank You." And since this is a celebration, you can put your hands together, you can stand up, and we can just do it Mayor Rudy Clay style and have fun with it, all right? If I never live another day, if I never see another smiling face, if I never breathe another breath or take another step, what we gonna say?
I wanna say thank you.
Oh, my. If I never hear what's to be heard, or if I never speak another word, oh my. If I never hear another voice, if I never make another choice, what we say?
I wanna say thank you.
Come on, let's sing it. I thank you for all that you've done. I thank you for all. That's it. Put your hand together. I thank you for being the God that you are. We thank you for bringing Rudy Clay into our life, God. Food on my table. Wanna say thank you. Oh, my. If we never have another talk, or me and my friend never take another walk, if I never see another sight, if I never taste another bite, Lord, I wanna say thank you. Oh, if I never scale the China Wall, or take a flight out and see the Taj Mahal. Listen, if I never make it to the mountaintop, or if my cash flow just up and stop, Lord, I wanna say, I've gotta say thank you, Lord. Thank you for Rudy Clay. I thank you for all that you've done thus far. That's it, all over the building, sing it. I thank you for being. Thank you for food on my table. I know you're able, Lord. Lord, I wanna say thank you. Can we take it up one time? Whoa! thank you for all that you've done thus far, Lord. Thank you for being the God that you are. I thank you for food. I know you're able. I want to say thank you. One more time. Let's take it up for the last time. Whoa, whoa, thank you for all. God bless you. Thank God for Rudy Clay.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, this little, yes, I'm, I keep telling you this little light. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Everywhere I go, would you stand with me? Let it shine. Jesus gave it to me. And I'm gonna, oh, Jesus, yeah, and I'm, oh, Jesus, let it shine. Gracious, magnificent God, we come to magnify your holy name. We thank you, God, because Rudy has called all of us here on this day. And God, we ask that you would take these old Mississippi lips and speak a quick word to these your people. Have the right of way. We'll be careful to always keep you the center of all we do. We ask your blessings upon this family, on Sister Chris and Rudy Jr. and all of the Clay clan. Keep them, O God. Be their shade upon their right hand. Be a lamp unto their feet and a light unto their pathway. We'll be careful, Lord, to praise you. And then, God, we ask that you would just hover over Gary, Indiana. Let your power and your grace, your Shekinah glory, give a breakthrough. You know what the city needs. And God, we know that you are able to make the crooked straight. And so, God, we just magnify you in advance for what you're going to do for the city of Gary. We thank you for supplying the needs of this city. We don't care what Satan says. We thank you for supplying the needs. We give your name praise and we give your name all of the glory. Take us now down into your word and we'll be careful to keep you first. In Jesus' name, and all of God's people said amen. Amen. You may be seated, brothers and sisters. I don't plan to be before you long. We have celebrated. But I ask that you be as patient with me as I have been with you. If indeed you need to take a washroom break, go right ahead. But just come right on back and see the conclusion of the whole matter. Protocol has been established over and over and over again. However, I must give respects to this family, to Sister Chris, and to Rudy Jr. and all of the family members. I pray that God would sustain you and keep you as he has kept me, as I have funeralized or eulogized three of my own siblings in the last 8 years, and eulogized 129 members in the last 7 years of Israel CME Church. I'm here today to tell you that I even tried to bargain with the Lord when my sister, Sister Chris, went home to be with the Lord. She was only 55 years young with everything going for her. PhD and a lovely family, an excellent job. But God came for her through cancer. And I told the Lord, I said, Lord, listen, why don't you take some of my days and give them to my sister Deborah? And the Lord was so sweet to rebuke me and to tell me I had no days. Didn't have any days to hand out or to bargain with. So yea, even the breath you breathe belonged to me. And so I said, thank you, Lord. I release my spirit to say yes to your will. When our loved ones go home, that's what we have to do. We have to release our spirit to afford ourselves to move on. Can I get an amen right there? Amen. So my brothers and my sisters, as I was looking for something to say to you today that I believe Mayor Rudy Clay would want me to say to you, I must admit that I struggled for just a moment, because it only took a moment to get the feeling of the Rudy Clay that I have known for the last 8 years, being his pastor for seven of those years, inviting him to the church where I am to speak in the eighth year. And the words that came to me were these: the Lord will take care of you. Look at somebody while you make an adjustment in your mind's eye and in your body and in your feet. Turn from side to side, because I'm going to preach in a minute. Uh-huh. And tell them the Lord will take care of you. Mayor Clay worked for all of God's people, black, white, red, and yellow. Mayor Clay was a willing servant, as we have heard over and over and over again. Mayor Clay was a brother. I say he was a brother, beloved. And can I just take a special break by saying I love all ethnic groups. Uh-huh. I love you if you are white. I love you if you are red. I love you if you are yellow. But there's something about an African-American man. I'm going to take my time right here. When a brother makes up his mind, whether he is light, dark, strawberry, vanilla, chocolate, with hair, no hair, tall, short, chubby, when he makes up his mind to do anything in the eyesight of God, and with God on his side, he will succeed. I'm talking about my own man now. A black brother, when he makes up his mind, can do anything. And so I salute Mayor Rudy Clay because he was one of those kinds of brothers. Yes, he was. Not only was he a man that got things done, but he also was a spiritual man. Yes. He was faithful to the Lord. How do I know? On many occasions, when I was struggling to handle certain situations with budgets, I would say, Lord, what in the world am I going to do? And the Holy Spirit would lead Mayor Clay to my office. Y'all don't hear me. I'm talking about what I know. Would lead him to my office. And he would say, Pastor, I said, yeah. He said, here is a check. And every time the check would be just what I needed. He was a spiritual man. Man that knew God and could hear God. That's why he was really successful. It wasn't the strategy, brothers, sisters. It was because he knew God. And God gave him favor. Mm-hmm. I said, God gave him favor. Have you ever heard him exegete a scripture? He could take a text and work it like you never heard it work before. Because he was a God sent man. So as I struggled there for a second to find a biblical character that would help me move along here today, the Holy Spirit gave me King David. So many ways, Mayor Clay had the traits of a King David. King David loved God's people, as we've heard on today. And Mayor Clay loved the people of God. I say he loved the people. He loved folk whether they loved him or not, whether they got along with him or not. I have never heard him say anything negative about anybody. He loved God's people. Just like David. David loved God's people. And he loved the work of the Lord. Mayor Clay loved the work of the Lord. I say he loved the work. Because there's no way you can be about social justice in the day that we live in and not love the Lord. Mm-hmm. David knew the people of his day. Mayor Clay knew the people of his day and time. There are other characteristics that time would fail me because I feel y'all pulling on me and telling me to hurry up and sit down. Y'all don't hear me. I feel you. But you might as well still relax for just a few more minutes and allow me to talk about this character that reminds me of Mayor Rudolph Clay. Therefore, when searching the Holy Writs and looking at the book of Psalms, where David is really showing himself strong, I was drawn to the 37th division of Psalms. Mm-hmm. 37th division of Psalms, where we see the theology of confidence here in Brother David. David is talking about what he has lived out in the book of Psalms, and expressly here in the 37th division. He talks about folk not liking you in so many words. I say he talks about it. He talks about it, and he moves us through this particular grouping of scripture. He says, do not fret because of those who are evil. Mm-hmm. Be envious of those who do wrong. For like the grass, they shall soon wither like a green plant. I just want to rush on here to this third verse that says, but trust in the Lord and do good. Trust in the Lord and do good and dwell in the land and enjoy safe pastures. And then he said, take delight in the Lord. See, that's where we have fallen. We are taking delight in scandal. I said we're taking delight in scandal. Watching sin on television. Getting our groove on by watching folk act a fool on television. I know y'all watching. I'm not the only one. Watching to see exactly what's going on. But here the text that takes what? Take delight in the Lord. Many of us have forgotten how to take delight in the Lord. But I love Mayor Clay because he took delight in the Lord. I want to move on because I got to get out of here. I got to let you go, and I got to go. Go with me in your mind's eye, however, to the key three scriptures where I want to lift up to you on today. And they are the 23rd verse, the 24th verse, and the 25th verse. And we're going to go home. And it says here, the Lord, let me read it from the King James Version first. That's the one that comes to mind. It says, the steps of a good man, I hear y'all, are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in what? His way. Look at God, the steps of a good man. And may I add, for those of us who are sisters, the steps of a good woman are ordered by the Lord. And I'm so glad today because I stand here as the first female to pastor the Israel CME Church after 89 years of male leadership. And what I loved about Rudy, Mrs. Clay, is that he was secure enough and free enough and manned enough to not try to rob me of the equality that God made room for me in. Oh, y'all better go on somewhere. Yeah. He was free enough He didn't try to get in there and throw blocks under me, because he understood who God was in his life. He delighted in the Lord. And then that 24th verse says, though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down. Y'all don't hear that. What that verse really saying, if he stumble, God is able to get him back up. Look at somebody and say, if you stumble, clean yourself off and get on back up. For the Lord, the text goes on to say, for the Lord upholdeth him or her with his hands. See, sometimes we make mistakes and sometimes we do things that are not right. Am I in here by myself? Or do I have a witness, Ed, now and then? Ed, now and then. I did say Ed. Ed, now and then. These old fleshly bodies get the best of us. And don't let no one put you on a pedestal, because they have sin in their lives just like you have sin in yours. Oh, y'all don't want to go with me. I'm trying to get out of here. But the Lord, look at somebody and say, the Lord upholdeth us if we fall. If we stumble, the Lord is able to get down in the muck and the mire and pull us up. Aren't you glad you know him? Look at somebody and tell them, the Lord will take care of you. 25th verse, and I'm almost out of here. I have David testifies here. He testifies to each of us. Rudy would want us to hear this verse, which is the key verse of this particular little meditation. It says, I have been young. Look at David. And now I'm an old man. He says, but yet have I not seen the righteous. Look at somebody and say, the righteous. Look at somebody else. Wake up and tell them, the righteous. I have not seen the righteous forsaken. In other words, God will always be on the side of the righteous. Y'all better leave me alone. God, quiet down, Essie. God will, I say God will take care of Gary, Indiana. Yes, he will. God, my Savior and my God, will take care of us, and he will not forsake us. And David goes on to say, I've never seen the righteous forsaken. Never seen the righteous forsaken, Chris. Or the seed, that's you, Rudy Jr. The seed begging for bread. God, he will take care of you. Whatever you're going through, just tell yourself that God will order my steps. And if he orders my steps, he will direct my path. Yes, yeah, I'm glad that I know him. I'm glad that I know Jesus for myself. For he is a way maker. He is, I said Jesus, he is a bridge over troubled water. He is bread when I'm hungry. Yes. God will take care of you, Gary. Don't fret yourself. God will take care of you, family. I do know that a pillar of your family, a pillar of this city, has been called home to glory. But God will take care of you. Let us say amen. Let us say amen again. We give God glory. We magnify his holy name for the assurance that God is the God of every road we trod. Let us prepare ourselves for the processional. I'm going to ask Pastor Welch, great pastor, another sister, well-trained, well-able to carry on the work of the Lord at Israel CME Church. How do I know? I was her field supervisor as she finished her Master's of Divinity, finished with a 4.0 at Garrett Evangelical Theological Seminary, well able to do the work of the Lord. Would you give us directions, my sister?
Amen. If the funeral directors will come. If we can have ladies come to take the flowers, and then the pallbearers, if you will come. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. If the choir would silently, he restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life,
and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall never slumber nor sleep.
I'm going up yonder to be with my Lord. Yes, I am. Yes, I am. Going up yonder.
Going up yonder.
Oh, I'll get there one day.
Going up yonder.
No more heartache, no more pain to be with my Lord. Going up yonder.